大家好, I'm Nathan Rich, aka 火锅大王. You know, I have some opinions about American politics, and my stance on things does change from time to time. I'm definitely no politician, but some of the ideas floating around these days are actually quite interesting. One of these buzzwords I've heard a lot about recently is reparations. And after doing some more research, I think I can comfortably reveal where I stand. That's right, it may very well be time for reparations. Here's Andrew Yang, the ABC running for president of the United States of America.
I 100% agree with the moral case for reparations.
Well, I think I do too, Andrew. You know, there has always been a climate of racism in America. That much I will definitely admit. Seems to be much better in the last few decades than it was before then. By the time I was born, nearly all the major pockets of racism were alleviated. Of course, there were flare-ups like the LA riots, for example, but at least in the big cities, racism was more or less gone. Or hell, maybe the alt-left is correct and I'm just living with blinders on. Maybe it was just my family that had friends of multiple ethnicities, and maybe it's because I grew up in LA. Who knows? But I will say this. Whatever the state of racism in America is today, we know that it was horrible in the 1800s. Large areas of the world were economically poor. Sadly, these were often some of the richest places culturally. In part through the exploitation of other countries, the United States and Britain rose to great power by the late 1800s. White people in both places considered themselves the highest class. But when you're the highest, that means everyone else is beneath you. And when people are beneath you, you can make them do whatever you want, they thought. So they sent merchants across the ocean to gather so-called inferior people for servitude. Some of the locals were deceived, others kidnapped. They were sold and transported all around the world: Cuba, Peru, British Guiana, Trinidad, Panama, Jamaica, the Philippines, Australia, the United States. The servants were often kept in miniature concentration camps called barracoons or inside ships. Out of sight, out of mind. Up to 40% of them died in those ships, their bodies just dumped in the sea. Those who earned wages earned 1/3 of what a white person did. They worked in mines, they built railroads and levees, worked plantations, and any other laborious task the whites viewed themselves as above doing. They were working to make other countries modern. Some of them had contracts, 5 years, 8 years. It usually didn't matter, though, because most of them died before the contracts expired. Those who did survive were usually forced to continue. There were areas that literally none of them survived at all. Thousands of people, all dead from brutality, far away from their families. The servants in America, many of which had originally come willingly, were so overworked that railroads were built nearly a decade ahead of schedule. After all, the inferior races could just be worked to death without any repercussions. And even in these circumstances, they were still known to complain less than whites. There were so many servants in America that Americans were getting upset about the competition. When immigrants are paid less than the locals, businesses mostly abandon the locals. Rather than stop the systematic kidnappings and slavery, America took the immigration problem out on the immigrants. The servants were intentionally and directly taxed more than the locals. That's on top of the lower wages. White people often rioted as servants arrived. Welcome to America. They weren't allowed to testify in court, meaning any white person could literally get away with murder in broad daylight so long as no other whites testified against them. There were arranged organizations to oppose the immigrants, who were stripped of the ability to become citizens of America based solely on their race. In 1867, workers protested, and in return, American companies simply starved them until they agreed to resume work. 1 week later, published medical journals blamed the servants for disease, calling them a health hazard. They were then blamed for an economic depression in 1870. 10,000 whites roamed San Francisco, burning down buildings and committing shootings in the middle of the streets. That was in 1877. In 1879, the California State Constitution condemned the ongoing, quote, human slavery. Some people didn't believe the narrative that these people were slaves. After all, they could challenge their superiors, rebel, petition government officials, or hell, run away. See, they aren't slaves because they can petition the government that's oppressing them. They aren't slaves because they can run away. So, you know, no big deal. Are these people insane? They were brought to countries in Africa because they would work cheaper than the locals there. Their experiences are described as horrendous. So horrendous, in fact, that the matter started getting international attention. The American ship Waverly suffocated almost 300 to death. Suicide by hanging or stabbing was commonplace. In 1856, hundreds killed themselves by intentionally drowning. In 1870, an American survey showed 61% of the females were prostitutes. Like their male counterparts, some had come willingly, deceived about their futures. And some had been kidnapped or coerced. The state cracked down by making it legal to reject immigrants suspected of potentially becoming prostitutes. In effect, it was a license to reject women servants who were of little use in the hard labor jobs. A few years later, they were formally banned outright. Servants who managed to survive their bogus contracts and weren't forced to work longer were allowed to live in concentrated areas of the town. This made them easy targets. In 1871, mass lynching took place in the so-called Negro Alley in Los Angeles. Up to 20 victims were robbed, shot, mutilated, and hanged in public. 10 white men were prosecuted. 8 were convicted of manslaughter, a much lesser crime than murder. But the convictions were then overturned, and no one was ever punished. The U.S. government then kicked off what became known as the driving out period. Laws were passed banning these slaves from immigrating, even voluntarily. It was the first race-based ban of immigrants in American history. Large-scale violence broke out as white mobs persecuted and massacred people based on their race alone. In Wyoming, homes were burnt down and entire families were murdered. Up to 50 people were murdered in the infamous Rock Springs Massacre. People were shot or burned to death. They were decapitated or cut into pieces. Many of the victims were so brutally slaughtered, their full bodies were never recovered. 16 white men were arrested in connection to the massacre. A grand jury declared, quote, "We have diligently inquired into the occurrence at Rock Springs. Though we have examined a large number of witnesses, no one has been able to testify to a single criminal act committed by any known white person that day." The men were released and greeted by hundreds of people who were cheering and clapping for them. No one was ever punished for this massacre. In Oregon, 34 workers were ambushed while working in mines, then murdered in cold blood. No one was ever punished. Newspapers pondered in writing if the killing of these people was of similar significance to that of white men. Some thought the murders were justified. Others compared the murders to that of women and children, apparently implying they were just helpless. After the massacres came more violence. White riots and mobs in Issaquah, Seattle, and Tacoma, Washington persecuted, evicted, harassed, terrorized, and killed. The wave of racial hatred and persecution lasted decades or longer. It's not known if anyone anywhere was ever punished for any of the wanton kidnapping, torture, murder, enslavement, and absolute brutality. So with that in mind, I hope you can see where I'm coming from when I say maybe it really is time for reparations. And here's a plan on how we can do it. At least it's a starting point for conversation. First, we can track down every single person who was abducted, coerced, or tricked into servitude and come up with a number for each one. Just as an example, let's say $200,000. We then find the closest relatives to that person and give them the money. If that person is unknown or there are no relatives left because, for example, they were all murdered in broad daylight in public, resulting in no prosecutions, then we can give the money to the government and return it to the people evenly by way of a one-time tax deduction or something like that. We know there were something like 750,000 people enslaved in this way. So let's see, 750,000 times 200,000 is $150 billion. I think that's doable, America. You can cut $150 billion from your defense budget and you'd still be spending twice the second biggest spender in the world. Then you can collect the outstanding money from Peru, Cuba, and other places by way of tariffs. Easy. So just think about how good it's going to feel to finally get this part of history some attention. You won't ever fix it completely, and the world will never forget, but it can forgive. And if the families of your victims have just a little bit easier life because you decided to do the right thing, that's an amazing step. So let's do it. Let's cut the defense budget by $150 billion for just 1 year, and we can all sleep well at night. So let's be on the right side of history. Let's get that reparation money together, and let's give it to the People's Republic of China and its citizens. And if I can say that, my God, why can't you? Or are you going to say there's not even a Chinaman's chance? Why don't you add that to your platform, Andrew Yang? Thanks, everybody. 谢谢.